Thanks, guys. Well, you know, thus far I've told you about two parts of our end-to-end Java story thus far tonight. I've told you about our Eclipse integration, which allows you to build all of this in one single location. And I've told you about our Java language support for App Engine, which gives you a place to deploy it. But that's only actually told you about half the story, building the back end of your application. The other half, building your front end, has some serious challenges too. If you've ever built a modern web application before, you know you have to deal with a lot of different browser quirks in different browsers that have different ways of running different JavaScript code. Once you've solved all those different browser quirks, then you have to worry about how large your JavaScript code base gets. When you have a lot of JavaScript code, it's not only difficult to manage, but it can become fragile. Just a few changes one place or another can cause it to be upset. Once you have the app working then, you usually have to optimize it. You have to optimize it to get the JavaScript to be faster, to get your download to be smaller, to reduce your bandwidth, and so on. In short, all of this becomes a tedious, error-prone process. And each bug you encounter takes you further away from what you actually wanted to do, which was build a great web application. So Google Web Toolkit, the last chapter in tonight's end-to-end Java story, addresses precisely this. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with Google Web Toolkit, the premise is simple. It allows you to write your application in Java, both the client and server, and then it compiles that Java code down to JavaScript. Now, when you do this, you gain a number of benefits. Since your code was completely written in Java, you can test and debug that locally using a standard Java debugger for both your front end and your back end code. Then, when your app is complete, you can compile that Java code to JavaScript. And that JavaScript is then a standard JavaScript file you can serve from any web server. Now, when it's doing that compilation, it also does a number of optimizations to your code to make it as small and as fast as possible. It also takes into account every major browser on the market, including IE, Firefox, Chrome, and more, so that your code accounts for all those browser quirks that I mentioned. That means you can spend a lot less time in QA and worrying if your app is blown up. And finally, Google Web Toolkit generates the source code for each browser independently. That means that when you use a Google Web Toolkit app, you only download exactly the code that you need to run on your browser for that app. Now, I think taken together, these increases in developer productivity, in making better code for your application, and making it more portable and running on more browsers, is a win-win-win that's tough to beat with handwritten JavaScript. Now, you might be wondering, why am I telling you about GWT tonight? GWT's been around for a while. In fact, we open sourced all of GWT back in 2006. Well, I'm talking about it tonight because for the first time, we've been able to bring Google Web Toolkit and App Engine together so that you can write a single application, both the front end and the back end together. It's fast, the applications you create are fast, standards-based, and can be deployed anywhere, on-site or on App Engine. And they're all written in Java, a single language. Now, many of you probably haven't seen Google Web Toolkit in action before. So to help with that, I'm going to invite Andrew back on stage. And he's going to take the guestbook application that you've already seen, and he's going to inject some Ajax-y goodness using Google Web Toolkit. Andrew?
Thanks, Kevin. Well, it's hard to imagine how I could improve my guestbook application, but I'm going to try. So here I want to bring my my web application, my guestbook application, into the modern world with an Ajax front end because I hear it's all the rage, and I'm going to do that with Google Web Toolkit. And I'm going to inject, as Kevin calls it, the Ajax-y goodness. And what this is going to be is no longer it's going to be a JSP page submitting to a servlet and then redirecting back. It's going to be here. It's going to have JavaScript that's going to submit my entries to the server on the back end and then list out entries here without ever leaving the page. So similar experience to most web apps these days. So I'm going to go back into Eclipse, and I've actually created that project already. And I'm just going to show you what it looks like and what it looks like to work with Google Web Toolkit on top of App Engine. So let me close out the other one, and let me open up this. Now, if you tried to build an Ajax application, you'll know that you have to worry about a lot of different things. You have to know about JavaScript for many different browsers and all the quirks. Luckily, you're not going to have to do that here. There are a few different, there's some changes you'll notice from the last project, notably in the package structure. So if I look here, I have client, server, and shared packages. Everything in my client directory is going to create my user interface on the browser in JavaScript. So the Java files are going to be cross-compiled into JavaScript and run in my user's browser here. My user interface is built here in the user interface Java class. And you can see I'm using widgets, creating text boxes and buttons, and I'm using click handlers, just like I would in desktop programming. What this is doing is providing a higher level of abstraction on top of JavaScript across all browsers so that you can focus on the application logic and not the browser quirks. So this code is going to run as JavaScript. In my server package, that code is going to run as Java bytecode on the server. Now remember, on the client, it's just JavaScript, there are no applets. On the server, it's bytecode. And then shared, because we're using Java to model our client code that's going to be JavaScript, we can actually share objects across both client and server. So if you remember, we had the entry object that we annotated earlier. I'm actually using this across both the JavaScript on my client and my server. Now you're hearing a lot about compilation, and you may be wondering, am I going to have to compile every time I want to make a change and see what happens? Luckily, you won't have to do that. So if I bring up my development environment here, I have the guestbook application running, and let's say, so you can see I have another long-winded post here. I changed my post here to another long-winded post by someone. And I don't like that, I want to change it back to posted by. So I'll go back here and I'll find that text. Go into my user interface. We'll just say another long-winded and pointless post. Just click refresh, just like I would with JavaScript. And so I made the change in Java, reflected in the JavaScript here in my development environment. Now the next thing we can do, because we're using Java across the entire application, is we can debug with the standard Java tools that we're used to. So let's say I'm having a problem with this list here, and I want to debug that. So I can go back into my Java source. I can go into this onSuccess method, and I'll set a breakpoint here on list. Then I'll go back and I'll create an entry. When I create an entry, that's going to trigger a refresh of the list. Well, let's see, it should trigger a breakpoint. I probably started it not in debug, so let's try that again. I'm going to start it up in debug. Now, it's important to note that you're not just debugging the, looks like we still had it running. You're not just debugging on the client or the server. You can debug across both. So I can debug that same entry.java file across both the server and then go and look at it across the client as well. So let's see if we have this going now. So now it started up the page, and then it triggered my breakpoint. This means I can step through the code, just like I would in any Java application. I can inspect variables and see what's going on up here. Now you may think that's not very amazing. But remember that this is JavaScript that we're debugging. This is Ajax code that we're actually debugging. So the last point I want to make is just a glimpse under the hood of Google Web Toolkit, and also a little bit about the performance aspects. So if you want to see, let's say I wanted to see what the actual JavaScript for this method looked like. I could do that. I could go into the web archive directory. This is where the JavaScript's going to be stored. And I could look for that. So let's see, I think it's called function on success. And so here's that method, and I can see the JavaScript, which is created from the Java. Now, it's not just Java to JavaScript compilation that's going on here, though, or cross-compilation. Because we're using Java, which is a static language, we can do a lot of analysis across the code base for compiler optimizations. I won't go into those here, but the point is that your app gets faster every time a new version of Google Web Toolkit comes out. So the end result of using Google Web Toolkit on App Engine is, one, it's very tightly integrated environment, so it's very easy to use both together, You can use them separately as well if you want. But it's productivity gains as a developer. But for your end user, it's also performance gains because your code's going to be a lot smaller that the user has to download, and the actual JavaScript's going to be a lot faster as well. Thanks, Kevin.